place that is a place of purity for Jesus, as the Holy Spirit has always been present on this campus. And so as I began to realize that, then maybe more pressure started to hit me, like, okay, there's a lot I've got to fill in for shoes of my grandparents. I've got to, I have a bunch of lives in my hand, thousands of students that are coming in, and how am I going to do that? I'm not the best speaker. I'm not the best talker. I don't know how to get up on a stage and voice what's necessary. I just wasn't good at that. What I was good at was sports, so that was easy for me. You don't have to talk much on the court. But to get up and articulate things in front of them, I was always fearful. Plus, the enemy had me in a stronghold of just the fear of man, trying to look good in front of them, trying to please man. And that's something I've had to pray daily. Lord, wipe away the fear of man, the fear of failure, the pride of life. It doesn't matter what I look like. It doesn't matter about me. Life is not about me. It's about you, and it's about people. And so as he's beginning to give me that understanding, and it took quite a long time for me to realize, you know what, I just need to be who I am. Mm. So I would fight that continually. I would fear going, and people would say, go up and you need to speak. And I said, no, that's not going to happen. But you've got to lead CF&I. So I always was bringing in other people, friends, and that's kind of what got us in trouble a few times here at CF&I. We'd bring in other people to lead for us, to be our speaker. And that finally, there was a day about 4 years ago in worship in the morning with the students. The Lord just gave me the revelation, understanding. He said, you know what? He helped me to see all I need to do. I need to go up there and voice what he's put in my heart. No matter how stupid it looks, no matter what I say, he will do the rest because he's put it in my heart. I just need to do my part, speak it out. He will be the one to touch people's hearts and to transform them. So that's where, at that day moving forward, I realized I can just be who I am. I know I'm not the best speaker. I know I'm not the best at leading, but I know my heart is right. I know my heart is solely after him. All I want is what he wants. I want to please him. I want to love him and love people. And I know because of that, the same with my parents, they're not the best at leading. They're not the best at speaking. But I know our hearts are truly after him, and that's all he needs. He can do the rest. He just needs an open heart, an open vessel, and he will touch people's lives. He will do the miraculous. We don't have to do all that in our strength.
I think that's such an encouraging word, whether you're a third-generation leader or you're a first-generation leader as well. I started pastoring at 24, and our church started to grow pretty quickly from what it was. And I remember standing in my kitchen one day and asking the Lord, was he trying to kill me? You know, like, why are you doing this to me? And I said, God, I'm inadequate. I don't have the skill. I don't have the experience to be doing this. And I remember the Lord really rebuked me, and he told me that my feelings of inadequacy were pride.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it was pride because it was selfish or it was self-leaning. It was looking to me. And he says, Derek, you have to understand that I am your adequacy. I am all you need, and I give you all the things that you need. So as a first-generation leader, if you're out there listening to this, or whatever generation leader you are, God will give you the grace to operate in whatever place that he's placed you in. And you found that, you're finding that, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you're walking in that, and God's growing it day by day.
Yeah, the more that I continue to pray, and God destroys that pride in me, the more I will walk in that, and I'll find that's the number one thing, in my opinion, is the pride that I have. And people say, oh, you're the most humblest person. No, I know better. I just know how to hide that pride for the most part, and that's what has held me back from which I could have done a lot more by now. But he's just slowly, he's patient with me. Luckily, he's
God, patient
because
so
it's been. It was, I mean, even though my heart changed, I continued to make wrong decisions, but he's been patient to walk me through this, to make me the leader he wants me to be. And that pride is the number one thing he's got to weed out of my life. It's dead to yourself. What he says, die to yourself, die to the world, die to everything that who the world looks at you as, and let me be the one that makes you.
There's no doubt about that. I think that every person, I know every person has to struggle, has to kill that spirit of pride that rises up. I mean, there's no doubt about that. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, pride of life. I mean, all of us have to walk through that. And sometimes we use humility or false humility as a source to ignore or not deal with the pride. And that a lot of times is pride. Well,
yep.
I don't have that. I'm so humble. Well, hold on now.
Yep.
You know,
yep.
Oftentimes that is it. And sometimes our selfishness is pride. And when we think anything self, when we put our eyes off of Jesus Christ, he's trying to deal with that spirit of pride. But when we begin to do that, when we start taking off the layers, when we start to do what we fear or do what we're not comfortable with, we find that God gives us the grace to operate in whatever it is. So, and I'm just amazed by this. I'm listening to him, and he doesn't necessarily enjoy this kind of thing all the time, but God gives him the grace. I mean, I think you've done fantastic here in leading the school and so forth, because God gives us the grace. So if you're listening out there, maybe you feel uncomfortable, but just because you're uncomfortable doesn't mean you're not called. God to give us the grace to do that as well.
Yeah, I just want to say, if you, any of y'all walking in the fear that you can't speak, you can't do something like lead, get in front of people, I would put myself, I was probably the worst at that. I so feared getting up on a stage in front of people. The devil had me in total bondage in that. But if you have to just trust in the Lord. So what I do, I turn on worship and I just get in his presence for 15, 20 minutes. Even before I just did this with you guys right now, getting on here, I just sat in my room for 30 minutes in worship, and he gives me that grace. He gives me that joy, that peace. And the Holy Spirit, when he attaches, when he connects with me, then stuff just flows out. But it's got to be through his strength for me, and the same with you. If you try to do it in your own strength, you're going to fail.
Well, and just in a practical way, you're not leaning or looking to your flaws or your inadequacies again. I mean, you're not looking to the things I can't. You're looking at him, and so you're able to be able to lead by your gaze. I mean, you're just totally concerned or occupied with him in worship, so it takes away all the things that you can consider your weaknesses. And so just practically, that's a good thing to do as well. So, yeah, for you guys that might think, man, I don't know what God calls me to do. They're making me pray at church or making me do something, and I don't want to do it. If you really begin to turn your eyes, set your attention on Jesus Christ, and listen, it takes however long it takes. I mean, it takes however long it takes. So if it takes 30 minutes for you or 15 minutes, maybe an hour, get in the presence of God, and he'll shake those things. I mean, he's faithful, right? I mean, he's faithful. And he's patient with us, and he's so kind. So we've talked about, you know, just kind of learning being the third generation minister, and we kind of talked about how the Lord has brought you out of some things and placed you back in leadership. Your father is the president of the school right now, and you're operating as the COO of the school, so you're kind of running the more...
The day-to-day operations.
They
put me the vice president this last year, just to let everyone know when he steps aside, I'll be the next president of the school. And so I finally accepted that and taken it on and said, I take ownership, Lord. You put me here. I'm going to lead, but I'm going to let you lead through me.
And that didn't come without its difficulties. That didn't come without its struggle. And that's another thing. I mean, maybe, again, you listen to this and you say it's not been easy. And just because something hasn't been easy doesn't mean that you're not called to do it. I mean, look at everyone in the Bible that God uses. There's some kind of thing that they have to come through. They have to make some decision to keep pressing in or pressing on. And so that didn't come without its difficulties. And so without getting really specific, how do you still know what God has called you to do and then deal with the rockiness or the roughness that comes with that too? How did you? Because you did. Even this last year, there were some uncertain days or some rockiness, and you just had to put your head down and keep going forward.
Before I get into mentioning what that was, last year, when into, like I said, 2008, he gave me a heart of worship. He helped me to realize at that point, spend time in worship with me, no matter what you're going through.
So
and that's what's got me through. That's what's everything. In the past, it was the drugs, it was the women, it was to everything else that the world had to offer. But he showed me it was a fight at that time. But the drugs and the parties and all that gave me joy or gave me happiness. It was a roller coaster ride, though. It was up and down. And then when he changed my heart, worship would give me that same joy. But there was a peace with it as well. I never had the peace before. I was always going up and down, a high and a low. Got to find something next. But with the worship, with being in his presence with Jesus, I began to just level out. I was always peaceful. I was always joyful. I was not going up and down. I wasn't miserable one day, happy another day. And so when I now going to what happened last year, COVID came through. But COVID was actually the best thing that happened to Christ for the Nations last year. I don't know how many places or people can say that. Mm-hmm. But for us, it was a blessing in disguise. There was some issues that happened on...
Didn't look like a blessing when it first came, but...
Not at all, but...
It tended to be.
But because of some... There were some leadership issues here. There were some decisions that were made, and there was a there were some people, without getting into too much detail, that was trying to take run CF&I in their own way. And so... Possibly me and my family might have been out after that. There was a vote that was going on, and we may not have been a part of CF&I. And so there were some leadership changes, face changes during the school year, but because COVID was going on, there was no students here personally. So it was mainly either online, but there was no one in the IB, no one getting on stage. And so they didn't get to see what was happening behind the scenes, all the chaos. It was probably one of the worst years we've ever had internally.
Wow.
At Christ for the Nations. But the Lord obviously saved us from really some bad social media or just advertisement out there by COVID shutting everything down so that we can fix all that internal stuff. And by September 1st, it was all changed and things was fixed. I was put back in my position. And then we begin to open in October. But because of COVID, students, the world, no one got to see all that mess. And so for us, that's just through all that, which your question was, how did I get through that? Again, God has given me a grace to put up with all this mess. I mean, I started in 2008 here. And with my grandma passing away, my dad kind of, you know, he reads, writes, and prays. And the chaos behind the scenes at Christ for the Nations, it's only a miracle that CF&I is still going. And that's why I know the Lord's hand is upon this place, because this place should not be here. We should be long gone. Any other organization or ministry with what has been happening in the finances, we just weren't the best at or leading. We weren't the best at finances. And we're just simple people that the Lord's put in place. But he's looking for us to be in unity here. He's looking for our hearts to be directed to him. He's looking for a place that is holy, that spends their life running after him, so that then when we get all that into place, then he's going to pour out his blessings. And that's what he's about to do, because he's been working on our hearts for 14, 15 years here. And I believe that he's brought us together, and the grace that he's put on my life and the passion for him and for people, that's where I'm at presently, and that's what he's been doing here with us.
Beautiful. Christ for the Nations now. I mean, again, we're in your dad's office right now. Yeah.
My grandpa's office, actually.
Really?
Gordon's, yeah.
Wow. I'm just looking at all this. It's beautiful, and there's so much going on. There's such a legacy here, and I think listening to you, and I'm thinking, man, we might be understating what God has done throughout all the world with the school. There's schools all over the world. Christ for the Nations has birthed, students have birthed, the school has had people graduate from all over the world. People from all over the world have come here, been trained, sent back into their communities. This youth camp that's going on right now, 4,000 students, your youth pastor, your pastor at some point probably went to this YFN, and not only that, music and so forth have come forth out of this place. And so we've talked about books, music, teachers, pastors that have been voices, either have spoke here or taught here or went to school here all over the world. It's remarkable.
Yeah.
So yeah. As we look back through Golan Lindsey's time sitting in his office, which is really cool, he's writing 200 books. Mom Lindsey, as she's referred to, taking the mantle, written many books, raised people up to do the work. Your dad writing books, teaching creation, science, and all of this. What is going on right now at the school? What are you proud of, excited about? What makes you get up every day and say, man, I'm here? And you're living here, right?
Right.
You live here. You live among the students.
Right.
You work here. What are you proud of, for lack of a better term, that makes you say, man, we are doing this, and you should be a part of it, or have your students or have your kids come be a part of it? What are you doing right now? What's going on at the school?
Well, let me start with when it was first opened, the generation that came to Christ for the Nations was a little older, a little wiser, kind of knew who they were, what they were wanted, not all of them, but it was just a different type of people that came here to get trained up. Now, that was 50 years. We just finished our 50 years last year during COVID. We're starting our next 50 years, and the generation that's coming in now, to me, that they're just jacked up. They're completely, they don't know who they are.